Okay.
All right.
Go ahead. We're at the Bethel Historical Society this evening.
I'd like to call the annual meeting to order. Our last annual meeting of the 1900s. So this is some sort of historic occasion. Will everybody please stand for the flag salute? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, thank you. You can all be seated. And we'll now have the secretary's report, please.
The August meeting was held at the room of the Moses Mason. Following the flag salute, the singing of America, the evening's business was opened with reading and approval of the minutes of the previous meeting and the monthly treasurer's report. There being no committee reports, no old business to discuss, the meeting was directed to new business. The annual meeting, slated for September 2nd, will include a reading of the nominees for the society offices, and the nominating committee is needed for the task. Charles Raymond will represent the trustees. It was proposed that Amy Davis and Dorothy Bartlett represent the general membership. Both were elected to fill the nominating committee vacancies. The annual meeting will feature the traditional potluck supper at 6:30 p.m. with a meeting to follow an hour later. The evening speaker will be Maine historian Neil Rolde, whose topic will be life and career of Maine historian James Phinney Baxter. Volunteers are still needed for Sudbury Canada Day. Interested parties are asked to contact Stan Howe. The gift of the month is a ledger from a Freiburg general store, 1887-1888, given anonymously. The evening's program featured Morris Palladou, author of the most recent scholarship on the life and work of John Francis Sprague, the subject of the Society's current exhibition. Sprague, born with severe physical handicaps and denied normal educational opportunities because of his parents' religious convictions, nevertheless gained an education and went on to live a life full of civic and scholarly attainments. The most remembered primary for his Sprague Journal of Maine History, 1913-1926. A labor of significance to all who are interested in bits and pieces of the state's past and its genealogy. The evening ended with a Persis Post talk and priest featuring Clemens.
Okay, thank you. Are there any additions or corrections to the secretary's report? Seeing none, it stands as read. And could we proceed to the treasurer's report, please?
Balance carried over from previous month, $5,715.85. Total income for the month was $11,909.82. The expenditures was $10,802.45. And balance carried forward in operating account, $6,823.22.
Okay, thank you. Are there any questions about the treasurer's report? If not, it stands as read. Are there any committee reports? It just so happens that I have a committee report, which Susan Herlihy asked me to give, very brief. It has to do with a couple of weeks from now, as part of the Bethel Harvest Fest, and by the way, I have copies of the overall program for the whole town coming up September 17th, 18th, and 19th. And I'll just read the part of particular interest to us. On Saturday afternoon, 1 till 5 p.m., the Bethel Historical Society Apple and Pumpkin Fest at the O'Neill Robinson House, right here. Pumpkin carving, apple toss, cider pressing, pumpkin whoopie pies for sale. crafts will be demonstrated and chairs rocked on the porch. And the Moses Mason and Robinson House is open for tours and exhibits. And then at 5, from 5 till 6, the Appletude Adjustment Hour, an opportunity to visit the Robinson House, wind down and reflect on the day while munching on apple hors d'oeuvres and drinking cider pressed on site. And Susan also asked me to mention that people are still needed to bake some pies for the Apple and Pumpkin Fest, and also to make some hors d'oeuvres. And I don't know whether, Sis, you have anything to add to that request or not.
No, she wants. She asked me to tell you that she'd like apple pies.
That's... And you're the one to see for people that can make something? Okay, fine. Thank you. Anyway, 2 weeks from this Saturday. At this time we traditionally, at the annual meeting, have a moment of silence for those members who have died since the annual meeting, and I will now read the names. Helen Smith, Margaret Varney, Barbara Rich Adams, Edgar Coolidge, Eunice Sisko, Albert Bartlett, John Nowlin, Ann Morris, Franklin Chapman, Marjorie Farwell Anderson, Gerald Kimball, Elizabeth Bailey, Rodney Howe, Louise Lincoln, and Dana Douglas. Could we all simply bow our heads and remember these people for a moment? Thank you. Now, some of the highlights of the last year. We traditionally do this at the annual meeting also. 50 new members were added, over 50 gifts of artifacts made. Many people visited the society, many groups visited, including the Pequawket League of Historical Societies, the North Country Chapter of the New Hampshire Genealogists. We had our first Apple Festival, and our first New Year's Bethel. We received a number of foundation grants and major donations to the Capital Campaign. The donation of a fax machine by John and Julia Fox of Andover, Maine and West Newton, Mass. Acquisition of a video camera through a grant from Exxon. It's in operation right now. Moving into the Robinson House, and isn't this a lovely porch to have functions on? The award of a grant from the Institute of Museum and Library Services, a MAP, so-called MAP 3 grant. A grant for the series on Maine Historians from the Maine Humanities Council to accompany the exhibit on John Francis Sprague. A gift of a computer and accessories from Jack and Lucy Nordahl. So it was quite a year, and many of you are ones, or all of you really, but a number of you were really instrumental in making it such a great year. One of the things going on with the Capital Campaign is our necklace, which Jackie's going to, I guess you can't really demonstrate
it. Well, I can't, and the aisles are rather narrow. I was going to walk up and down, but I have it on if you'd like to see it. The tickets are $20 a piece, and the drawing is going to be on Valentine's Day next year. But it's a beautiful necklace, and a lot of, well, it's the stones were mined here, and it's been specially designed by Jim Mann, and I think it's been a wonderful gift to the society, and will, I know, be shown in the Capital Campaign and what we're doing to this wonderful house. But I have it on if you'd like to see it, and I have the tickets here if you'd like to buy some.
Okay, thank you very much. Many of you have already seen it. For those who haven't, it's definitely worth seeing Jackie. I guess you'll stay a little bit after the program, give people the chance to do that, or during refreshments, perhaps. Or do we have refreshments, having already had them? I retract that last statement. After the meeting, anyway. Okay, at this time, again, traditionally at the annual meeting, the presentation of the Marjorie MacArthur Knoll Volunteer Service Award. And Sis Post is going to make the presentation.
This is always a very special occasion because we recognize people who have been just wonderful here and have helped us in so many ways. The couple that we are having tonight, I'm especially interested in presenting them because they are a couple that I have known ever since I came to Maine, more than anyone else here. And both of them are following a family tradition. Their family has always been noted for their service to the community. And they are just exactly like their forefathers. Besides being on the trustees, they've been here. They've also done other help that Stanley asks for. Always willing, besides money, they've given their hands and their work. And Sylvia has been wonderful. She has been also a big help to me. She's been on the committee with me for all these years, and I never call her up, but she says, sure, I'll make bread, sure, I'll make cake, sure, I'll do this. And I know that when Stanley calls Bill up, Bill does the same thing. So Bill White and Sylvia White are going to be honored tonight with the Knowles, the big silver bowl, as our people for this year.
We're going to get a shot of you. Be sure you stand right so we get a good shot of you people getting presented. Because
we have to wait for them to come.
Yeah, yeah.
And we separated them tonight, and I thought after, oh dear. Bill and Sylvia have been so special to me, too. They just have. And I'm so happy to present them because they have honestly earned them. They truly have earned them.
Hold it there so Tom can get a picture.
Okay, one, two.
And get another,
take another one. Yeah. Be sure.
You want to get a little closer?
Yep.
Yeah, get a little closer right up this way.
I was only half wrong before. Sis says that the refreshments are what's left over. Okay, new business. The next meeting will be on October 7th. It will feature the annual What's It? And Collectibles Night. All sorts of strange things show up, and everybody has to say what they think it was or is or something. And you get all kinds of queer answers. So, in fact, if you have some funny objects, especially from the old days, let Stan or Randy know, and we can include it in the program. Okay, speaking of artifacts, the artifact of the month, Randy's going to speak about.
Where are you, Randy?
Right down here. The artifact of the month is hanging over the fireplace mantle in the middle room. So after we finish, hope you all have a chance to go in and take a look at it. It's an 1895 landscape oil painting, recently given to the society, attributed to the artist J. Spaulding Record, whom we don't know much about yet, given to us by society member Rick about the painting, is that it shows the Mayville Church in the foreground. Any of you that have studied Bethel history, you know that we have a Garland Chapel attached to the present Congo Church, and Reverend Garland preached in the Second Congregational Church, which was right behind the Norseman Inn barn, right on Route 2. We don't even have a photograph of the church, but now fortunately we have this painting that shows the church. Later on in its history, it was used as the exhibit hall for the Bethel Fairgrounds. and it was torn down in 1909. So do take a look at the painting. We hope to get it framed later on, but it's really a wonderful addition. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. Next order of business is to nominate officers and trustees for the coming year. So I would ask for a report of the nominating committee. Dorothy Bartlett will give this report.
We, the undersigned members of the trustees for 3 years, Walter Hatch and Jackie Van Loon. That's the report.
All right, thank you very much. We also entertain, they can do so at this time. Seeing no other nominations, I would ask somebody to make a motion that we accept the full report of the nominating committee for all of the officers and trustees. Would anybody make such a motion?
I shall move.
Do we have a second? Could we have a show of hands, all those in favor? All those opposed? It's unanimous, and we have our new officers and trustees for next year. And I'd like to, at this time, thank the retiring trustees, Charlie Raymond and Paul McGuire, who, for their loyal service and valuable service during their 3-year periods. And I think I've covered all of the announcements. So now, at this time, Stanley will introduce our...
Before I introduce the speaker, I'd just like to pay tribute to Walter Hatch. He didn't mention as he retiring president, but I think all of us owe a great deal to Walter. He's been a great president. We couldn't have, I don't think, succeeded getting through this very difficult period of going into the capital campaign with such energy and such drive and all the other things he's tended to. So I think maybe we ought to give Walter a standing ovation because he's really done a great job as president of the society. Our speaker tonight, I've known for some years. He's a wonderful friend of Maine history and the arts, and he's just a great person to know, and it's wonderful to have him in Bethel. Neil Rolde was a former 8-term legislator from York County and assistant to former Governor Kenneth Curtis. He is currently chairman of the Maine Public Broadcasting Corporation and also of the Bigelow Mountain Laboratory of Ocean Sciences. His books include an illustrated history of Maine, a narrative history, So You Think You Know Maine, York Is Living History, Sir William Pepperell of Colonial New England, Your Money and Your Health, and what's the most famous book which you can get to tonight is The Baxters of Maine, Down East Visionaries. So I'm delighted to have, and I think all of us will be delighted to have Neil here tonight to tell us about James Phinney Baxter, the father of the better known Baxter Percival. Neil.
Well, thank you very much, Stanley. I'm certainly very deeply honored to be here tonight and to your last annual meeting before the new millennium. And I speak to a lot of groups, and I have to say I've never been in an arrangement like this. But I suppose after all those years that I was up in the legislature, I should have learned to talk out of both sides of my mouth. The letter that invited me here said that you would be featuring lectures on Maine historians, and particularly regional ones and state ones. And one that's a new one for me, because I decided I'd bone up a little bit on Bethel before I came here, is William Berry Lapham, whose book I went through and tried to learn something more than I knew about Bethel before I came up here. And I found it very interesting. In fact, one of the things that I absolutely didn't know that amazed me was the incident that you had a small battle of the revolution up here in Bethel, something that I had never come across. And I think the work of learning about what you're doing and what your organization is doing and the kind of resources you have, I look forward very much to coming up here and working in your library and looking at some of the research you have, because my next book is going to be a book, History of the Maine North Woods. And I think, in fact, Arlen Jodry and I were on a trip just about a year ago when we went to look at Champion Paper Company's lands over in Hancock County. So I look forward very much to coming back here and using the wonderful resources that you have. Now to James Phinney Baxter. Let me start with some background on the Baxter family itself. And like most of us, the Baxters came from somewhere else, from outside of Maine originally. In fact, of course, from outside the United States originally. The first Baxter who came to this country was Simon Baxter, who came from England, of course. And he came to Connecticut, lived in a little town called Hebron, Connecticut. And then the line that eventually led to James Phinney went through another Simon, who also lived in Connecticut. He was captured as a British soldier, a New England soldier, by the Spanish in an attack on Havana back in 1762. His first son, Elihu, was not born in Connecticut, but in New Hampshire, like a lot of the original settlers from England who went to Connecticut and Massachusetts. They began moving north. So the Baxter family moved up to Lebanon, New Hampshire, over near the Connecticut River. This Elihu had 15 children, and one of his sons was another Elihu, who by that time, this family had moved across to Norwich, Vermont, where the second Elihu was born. This second Elihu was the father of James Phinney Baxter. As a young man, he married a woman. The first person, woman he married was a woman named Clarissa Sims as a young man. And they had been married for just about a year when she decided, it was in the month of April, to cross the Connecticut River, which was still frozen at that time, on horseback. And the ice was not heavy enough to hold her, and she fell through and drowned. And it happened on April 1st, actually. And when he was told about it, he first thought it was an April Fool's joke, that people were trying to kid him. Sometime not too long after that, he married again. He married a woman named Sarah Cohn, who came from an old Connecticut family, descendant of one of the governors of Connecticut. And he had already, by that time, he had studied to be a doctor at Hanover, New Hampshire. Now, in those days, there were not medical schools. You just went and you studied with somebody who was already practicing. So that's what he did. But because of the tragedy in that area, he wanted to leave that area. So once he had married Sarah Cohn, they moved to Maine. And he first moved to Wayne, Maine, lived there for a short time. And then in 1812, he moved to Gorham, Maine. And the reason, ostensible reason he moved there was because the regular doctor in Gorham, a man named Folsom, had gone off to join the army and fight in the War of 1812. So Dr. Elihu Baxter went to Gorham, and he actually stayed there until 1832, even after Dr. Folsom returned. James Phinney Baxter was born in Gorham, Maine, on March 23rd, 1831. He was named James for an uncle of his named James in Ontario, who was a very successful merchant and a member of the Canadian Parliament. The Phinney came from a friend of the family, a man who was a minister in the town. He was named James Phinney, and he was the son of the first resident of Gorham, Maine, Captain John Phinney. And when James Phinney Baxter was born, Deacon James Phinney was in his 90s, and he's described as, James Phinney remembers how his parents described how old James Phinney blind, would hold him in his arms, the little boy, James Phinney, and bless him. Interesting enough, Gorham, for your background, was called, originally called Narragansett Number 7, like Bethel, as I understand, was called Sudbury, Canada. And it was similar because Narragansett 7 was those veterans who had gone to fight in King Philip's War were given land, and just like the ones who went on the expedition with Sir William Phipps to Canada were given land in Canada, Sudbury, or Sudbury, Canada. Dr. Elihu Baxter must have inherited some restlessness from his family because he then left Gorham. He had six children by that time, four boys and two girls, and he went north in Maine. He went up to Stillwater, which, if you know the area, it's now Orono. It's a section in Orono. He bought land, but he his son-in-law, who had married one of his daughters, lost him a lot of money on some of the speculation that he was going, land speculation that he was into, which was a very common thing at the time. He also worked for a while as a doctor in the town of Levant, and one of James Finney's brothers, older brothers, Hartley, went to sea and was lost at sea. But the childhood events that, some of the childhood events that James Phinney had after he moved up to that part of Maine, which was very rural at the time, had a lasting impression on him. One in particular dealt with some bear cubs that had been found by local, and they were brought into the local store. And one of the cubs got into the sugar, and the store owner wrapped them on the nose, and the cub got sick and died. And then the other cub died as well. And for his entire life, James Phinney was what we would call an animal rights person. He just loved animals. He could not stand any kind of cruelty to animals. And he was he was violently opposed to any kind of vivisection. And even when he died, he left a thing in his will saying nothing in his will could be given to anybody who practiced vivisection. And his son, Percival, after him, also inherited that sort of trait. Dr. Elihu bought some parts of the town of Parkman, and but he didn't stay up in that area. He moved next to China Lake, and here, James Phinney, the young boy, had another set of impressions made on him, and in effect, it was sort of his first brush with history, because this was in 1839, and you probably have all heard of the Aroostook War, the bloodless Aroostook War, in which we almost went to war with Canada and with Great Britain. And while he lived in China Lake, the soldiers, the Maine soldiers who were marching up into Aroostook County, went right through China Lake. And he describes how he and his boy friends in the area would pick up sticks and march along, mimicking the soldiers. It was also, he remembered very well, the election campaign of the next year in 1840, which was the election of Tippecanoe and Tyler too, when William Henry Harrison was elected president. And he remembers the campaign songs having been sung in the town tavern. He was 10 years old when they left China Lake and moved to Portland, and they moved all over the city of Portland. And in fact, not until 1849 did they actually settle in one place at a address, 26 Brown Street, which is just off of Congress Avenue and Congress Street in Portland. And that's where Dr. Elihu lived out the rest of his life. James Phinney Baxter went to Portland schools. He had a brief time where he was sent to live with his sister, Sarah, in Lynn, Massachusetts, with her and her husband, a man named Joseph Barry. And again, here's another great impression that stayed with him for the rest of his life. James Phinney hated his brother-in-law, Joseph Berry, who tormented him all the time, and was also an alcoholic. And one of the impressions that on James Phinney was that he was always a lifelong teetotaler. He had no use for alcohol whatsoever. As a young boy, he also did lots of reading on his own. And his father was not very sympathetic with that. He claimed that someone who did all this kind of reading, and particularly who read a lot of novels and literature, that it was only for cranks and good for nothings, he said. And so, with a really minimum education, there was no question of his having a college education. At age 18, he knew that he had to go out in the world and earn a living. So, and everything that he knew, and in later years, he was a very erudite man and a marvelous historian, had two honorary degrees from Bowdoin and was a trustee of Bowdoin. But everything had really been self-taught. Again, in those days, there were no law schools. And he thought at first he wanted to be a lawyer. So in order to become a lawyer, you just went and studied and worked in the office of a practicing lawyer. So he went to Boston to work with a very famous lawyer of the time named Rufus Choate. And I think after about 3 or 4 months, both he and Choate agreed that this was not going to work out. And so he went back to Portland. Choate called this young man from Maine a robust down-easter with a skedaddling active mind. Maybe not the best thing for a lawyer. Previous to going down there, he had helped his brother William out. William owned a hardware store on Middle Street in Portland. And so he went back and he started working with William. And then he was given a chance to go into business himself with one of the people he met. One of his uncles in Vermont lent him some money, and even his father chipped in $500, and he bought into this business. At the same time, he had also fallen in love with a young woman in the neighborhood named Sarah Kimball Lewis, and it was her large eyes, he said, that had attracted him. She was a very, very beautiful woman. It was a sort of a retail business that they were in. They sold cutlery and threads and buttons and needles and things like that. And he got the idea of making a catalog and was sort of a pioneer in the whole idea of catalog sales. So I often think of him as a forerunner of L.L. Bean. And that worked out, and it did well, and he was making enough money to get married. Their first child was a girl, her name was Florence, but she died before she reached the age of two. And then they began to have a series of boys starting in 1857, all of whom, and there were five eventually, were strong and healthy kids and grew up to manhood. Portland was a booming town at this time. It was the early 1860s. He was able to pay off his uncle in Vermont, and he was told it was the first time a relative had ever paid him off. He changed partners, and eventually he went into partnership with a man from Limerick, Maine, named William G. Davis, who was a salesman. And it was said he was such a good salesman that he could sell moose to a cow. In 1861, young James Phinney, as a budding young businessman, was redoing his father's house on Brown Street in Portland. And while he was doing that, his family had to move out, so they boarded with a man in Buxton, who was to have a very strong influence on James Phinney's future. This man's name was Ira J. Batchelor, and he was the clerk at that time for a man who was in business in Westbrook by the name of John Winslow Jones, who was in the canning business. And the bachelor kept telling James Phinney Baxter, that's a good business for you and Davis to go into. And so they took his advice, and they decided to go and form a canning company. And they started with lobsters. They started canning lobsters, actually, in Deer Isle. And that proved to be quite successful. But the biggest breakthrough was in canning corn. And this Winslow family had gotten into the business because one of them, a man by the name of Isaac Winslow, had invented a type of knife that had a gauge on it that could cut the kernels off an ear of corn. I don't know how it works, but it was really revolutionized the whole business of canning corn. You could gauge it so it would cut the whole thing off, and this John Winslow Jones was his nephew, but he wasn't a particularly good businessman. In any event, James Phinney Baxter and Davis eventually bought the patents for the knife and some other things that they owned the patents to for canning corn. And they started something called the Portland Packing Company. And before long, the Portland Packing Company was, quote, the largest food packing firm in the world, unquote. They had 21 plants. They employed over 3,000 people. They were very, very successful. They were making, at one point, something that was just unheard of at that time was $700,000 a year, which is many, many millions in today's money. James Phinney was, he did a lot of the traveling. He had to leave his family quite a lot, traveled all over the eastern half of the United States, getting orders, and even more so, setting up agents to handle their produce. By now, they had five boys, and I'm sorry, they had four boys by this time. They had another girl, Mabel, who died in infancy, and they had another a daughter. And then she was pregnant with another child, but by this time, Sarah had become quite ill, and it's never specified what her illness was, but I suspect it was tuberculosis. And he went out, they spent one summer with some friends out in Gorham, which was then real country, and on a farm out there. So he bought a farm out there called the Smith Farm, thinking if they moved out there, this would be better for her health. She had her final son, Rupert, out at the Smith Farm, but it was too much for her, and she died shortly after that. This was obviously a very devastating blow. He was, at this point, left with six children, and he just didn't know where to turn. And then things got even worse. The only female child who had survived early childhood was a little girl named Alba, who they called Dolly. And she was 4 years old at the time. And then one day she accidentally tipped over in her chair and very badly injured her spine. She was taken to family doctor's home in Portland, and she was nursed by a woman from Massachusetts named Perkins, but she died. And James Phinney is quoted as saying that life was well nigh unbearable at this point. However, not too long after this, he began visiting Mrs. Perkins, who had taken care of the little girl, who was a widow herself. And within little more than a year after his own wife's death, he married Mehitabel Cummings Proctor, who was known as Hetty. And she had three children. He had three children by her. He used to refer to them as the second litter. two were girls, Emily and Madeline, and they all lived to adulthood, unlike the girls in the first family. And in between those two was his most famous offspring, Percival Proctor, which was his mother's maiden name. And she never called him Percival. She always called him Proctor. So things were going very well for James Phinney now. He had a wife he adored, who his family was all under control. He'd started taking a little time off from the business, vacationing in the White Mountains. And then he almost died from pneumonia. And it was very serious for many weeks. They didn't know whether he'd live or die, but he finally pulled through. And he recuperated in the White Mountains and actually took painting lessons from a well-known Portland artist named Harrison Brown while he was up there. And he was actually quite a good painter. And in my book, there's a picture of one of his paintings. But his wife, Hetty, was even better. She was, and there's a picture there of hers in there as well. It's also the time when he started to indulge his love of history. And it was particularly the history of Maine and New England. He'd learned of something called the Trelawney Papers. These were letters between a man in England named Robert Trelawney, who was the Lord Mayor of Plymouth, the city of Plymouth, and his overseer, whose name was John Winter, over here in America on Richmond Island, where Trelawney owned that island and had settled it with settlers. And I don't know if any of you know where Richmond Island is, but it's right off of Cape Elizabeth. And at that time, it was a thriving community with all these people that had come over from England. Today, if you go and see it, it's totally deserted, and you can see it from Cape Elizabeth. There's nobody, I think it's privately owned. So these are a whole series of letters of what the life was like, and Winter was writing back and forth to him all the time about all the really interesting characters that were living there and so forth. So James Phinney got a hold of the Trelawney papers and decided to publish them. So that was really his first foray into history. Then in the year 1885, he decided to go to Europe. And he took almost a whole year. And he took the second litter with him, his three children. And Percy, for example, spent a good part of that year in a school that's part of Eton, sort of like a preparatory school for Eton, the famous, they call them public schools, but they're what we would call private schools here. And while he was over there, he spent most of his time in England and some time in France. And what he was doing was he was collecting documents that related to the history of Maine from the English point of view and also from the French point of view. And all in all, he collected over 21 volumes. And he even had a chance while he was there to visit Sir Robert Trelawney, who was a direct descendant of the man who had written the Trelawney papers. When he got back, at one point he divested himself of his interest in his business to his sons from the first marriage, who had now grown up. So he had lots of time to devote to other activities. He had lots of civic responsibilities. Among them, he was at first the vice president, then later the president of the Maine Historical Society. He was a trustee of the Portland Public Library. He was the president of the Portland Savings Bank. He was the director of the Portland-Ogdensburg Railroad and a couple of other railroads. He was the founder of the Associated Charities of Portland, which is now, today, the United Way, and the founder of the Portland Society of Art. So he had his hands in a lot of different pies, plus a lot of business interests, because he had made an awful lot of money, and he had put it into real estate in Portland. They built several office buildings. he bought land all over Portland. There's one area over near Stevens Avenue, I don't know if you know that part of Portland, where most of the streets are named after his children. And so he obviously was the one who put those streets in back then. He gave the citizens of Portland a new library. Up until that time, Portland did not have a library as such. It had a couple of rooms at the Portland City Hall. And as one gentleman wrote, it was usually full of little boys who didn't smell very well. Eventually, he was pushed to run for mayor. And he was although his father had been a lifelong Democrat, he may be remembering William Henry Harrison, who ran on the Whig ticket. He was a lifelong Republican. So finally, he agreed in 1892, although he never was crazy about politics or politicians, he finally agreed that he would run. And he ran against a Democratic incumbent mayor, a man by the name of Darius Ingraham. And in his very first election, he lost. But then there was an examination of the ballots. And it seemed that some ballots, particularly from the very Republican wards of Portland, were missing. And that's the kind of thing that went on in those days. And to the credit of Mayor Ingraham, he recognized that something was really fishy. And he refused to accept being elected. He wouldn't sign the certificate of election. So they had to have another election. And in the second election, James Phinney did win by about 300 votes. All in all, he was elected 6 times as mayor of Portland. And not consecutively, because on 2 occasions he was actually beaten. Once within his own party by a faction that was tired of his being as honest as he was. And then the second time by a Democrat, and that was the last time he ran. And but his biggest project was what eventually became Baxter Boulevard, was the idea of having a magnificent boulevard around the back part of Portland, the back cove area, they call it. I don't know, you've probably all seen it as you've driven through Portland. And it's a tidal area. And in the old days, there was also sewage. It was just awful place. I mean, it just stank, and particularly at low tide. And there's a famous story of a society matron from Boston who drives up, and she sees this awful place and smells, and it looks full of garbage and everything, because the water's all gone. And she goes and she upbraids the mayor, and she says, "That's terrible, I just can't do it, you know, it's just awful." And then she travels somewhere north and comes back, and it's full tide. And then she said, "Oh, that's much better." But anyway, his plan was to make that a beautiful area. And he also set out a comprehensive plan of parks for beautifying Portland, somewhat based on what Boston had done with the Fenway and the Back Bay area and so forth. In fact, he hired the most famous landscape architect in America, Frederick Law Olmsted, the man who designed Central Park in New York and a lot of other famous areas, to draw up a master plan for Portland, which still exists and still hasn't been entirely carried out. And they're still working on it. In fact, there's supposed to be, I think the Maine Historical Society is doing a major exhibit coming up this month on the park plans and the parks of Portland, so you might be interested in that. But that was his great goal, and it took forever, and it cost him a couple of elections. It was very hotly contested. I also think that it was sort of a model for what his son Percival later did with buying up Katahdin and making that into Baxter State Park. Was that sort of persistence, the idea of a vision, and pursuing it, even if it took many years and all kinds of effort to do it. But his son Percy himself wrote that the main thing his father hoped to be remembered for was as an historian. As Percy stated in one of the things he wrote about his father, his political and business successes were to him as nothing in comparison with those in connection with his historical work. He loved the state of Maine and its history, and he loved the state of Maine, and its history was as familiar to him as is the alphabet to most people. So in Europe, as I said, he not only collected documents in England, but also in France, and he knew French well enough, or taught himself French well enough, to translate passages of the works that he found there. As an interesting thing, I mentioned there were 21 volumes that he came back with. But if you go to the Maine State Museum, where those volumes are today, you'll only find 20. And the reason is, there's a little pamphlet that tells you, he was working on a set of papers from an interesting man in the history of New England and Canada as well, named Jean-Paul Mascarene, who was a French Huguenot whose family fled to England, and he was actually at one time the governor of Nova Scotia, and he was very much involved in the French and Indian Wars. So Baxter had the papers of Jean-Paul Mascarene, and he would go to his office and work on them. And one night one day he was working on them, and he left, and he forgot one thing, which was he always locked them in the safe when he left. And we went, but he forgot with these particular papers. And when he went back the next morning, the office had burned, and the papers burned, and he was never able to get another copy from France of these papers. So that's why there's only 20 volumes instead of 21. Some of his books that he did about France using this material were Pioneers of New France and New England and a memoir of Jacques Cartier. And Jacques Cartier was one of the very earliest explorers to come to the New World. He came from Saint-Malo in France back in the 1500s, actually. And so Baxter found manuscripts of Cartier's voyages in Paris when he was there, and he had translations made and published them, and he also included in this memoir of Jacques Cartier about a 70-page essay that he wrote himself, which is excellently done on all the voyages. It was a really fine piece of history. The Pioneers of New France and New England, I found, was more of a polemic than an actual objective piece of history, because he was taking very much the view of a New Englander against the French during the French and Indian Wars, and particularly in this case against a Catholic priest by the name of Father Sebastian Rao, who lived with the Indians in Norwich Walk. And we in York were not very happy with him because we blamed him for the massacre of York in 1692, that he was inciting the Indians. And so it was a group of guys from York in the 1720s who went up and attacked Norwich Walk and killed Father Rao. But James Phinney was continuing that fight many, many years later. But it's an interesting piece of history, even if it's a little bit prejudiced in a certain way. And there were he's been under some criticism for taking what at that time was a very understandable point of view, which was a very Anglo-Saxon point of view towards history. He was obviously very proud of his English ancestry, and he was accused of, and has been accused over the years of being prejudiced against other peoples and so forth. But one of the areas where that happened was when he died, he left some money and I'll get into this a little bit later in more detail, to the city of Boston to build what he called a pantheon. It was to be like Westminster Abbey, where all the great heroes of the early Puritans would be honored. And in later discussions over this, some people accused him of being overly waspy in his attitudes. But in all fairness, the man was, he used to take Jewish children from New York, poor Jewish kids, into his home in the summertime. He was very open-minded. His son, Percival, was, back in the 1920s, was the number one enemy of the Ku Klux Klan. When they were actually very strong in Maine back in the 1920s as an anti-Catholic organization. And in fact, James Finney's daughter, Emily, also was a convert to Catholicism. So he was very open-minded, but in the light of our looking back on his attitudes at the time, they seem a little strange to us in this day and age. I just want to make that. He was a, he did pioneer research on the man who's been called the father of Maine, Sir Ferdinando Gorges, who was very important to my town, town of York, which was at one time called Gorgiana. Sir Ferdinando Gorges was the man who was given the grant of what essentially became the state of Maine by the King of England. And he was going to establish his capital city at what is now York, and he had plans to make this great area have a cathedral there. It was going to be a big English market town and so forth, called Gorgiana. That never happened, of course, but he was really the person who started most of the discoveries and exploration of this part of the United States. And so he did some really interesting research on Gorges, found a lot of the original papers which had been thought lost, and he wrote a book called Ferdinando Gorges and His Province of Maine for a group called the Prince Society in Boston. He was also a member of the New England Historical and Genealogical Register, and for 20 years its leader. He was 30 years, actually, as president of the Maine Historical Society. And he did many monographs on Maine history. And it was interesting in reading his papers to read some of the field trips that he would have the Maine Historical Society take. One of them that I wrote about in the book was to this area, to Freiburg, and did a paper on, he presented a paper of his own on the battle, famous battle at Lovewell's Pond, which really had a very great influence on, because it eventually drove most of the Indians out of this area, on the settling of this part of western Maine. The Pantheon, let me just explain a little bit about that, because it's a kind of a funny story. He left, I think it was about $50,000 to the city of Boston when he died in 1921. And the stipulation was that when it reached $1 million, the money was to be put into investments, and when it reached $1 million, Boston then had to build this pantheon, or they would have to give the money back to Portland. And then Percival himself, when he died, left more money. And so the money reached more than $1 million. And Portland said, hey, wait a minute, Boston, you guys owe us this money. And then the mayor of Boston said, well, no, we didn't count it quite that way. We'd have to count when this way and that way and so forth. Well, anyway, it got to a point where Boston couldn't stall any longer, and of course there's no way they could build this kind of building for that kind of money. And so the headlines were, you know, Boston and Portland ready to go to war, and they went to court, and and the Baxter family got involved because they wanted it to stay in Boston because that was what James Finney's wish was, and it cost them money to hire lawyers. And so anyway, to make a long story short, I think it finally got up to close to about $2 million, and they finally agreed. Portland got $400,000, and Boston kept the rest. And of course, they're not going to do a pantheon, but they're going to do some kind of a monument to the immigrant population, people who came to Massachusetts, so or to New England. So anyway, and I guess the $400,000 is supposed to be spent on Baxter Boulevard. I don't know if that is finally going to happen. One of the things that James Finney had talked about a lot was doing a history of Portland to supplement the great work of William Willis, which was one of the first major ones, and also to do a history of Maine, because there apparently at that time there wasn't a fresh new history of Maine. He never did that, and it's really to be regretted that he never did. He was a very busy man, but also, in a way, I think he got very sidetracked on a pet project of his. And that was, he finally came out with a 700-page book. And it was called The Greatest of Literary Problems, The Authorship of Shakespeare's Work. And he spent all of these 700 pages trying to prove that Shakespeare did not write Shakespeare's works. And that the person who did was Sir Francis Bacon. And then also, not only did Bacon write Shakespeare, but he wrote all of Christopher Marlowe, and he wrote Spenser's The Faerie Queen, and he was the illegitimate son of Queen Elizabeth and Lord Robert Dudley, the Earl of Leicester. It's a brilliant piece of work. It's beautifully written, and I think in a wasted cause. And he thought it would make his literary reputation, and of course it didn't. And people said, you know, we just wish he'd done more about the history of Maine. But it just took up, you know, must take a major, I mean, if you try to read it, you can just see the immense amount of work that he did, the scholarship and all the other books that he read. And he read Audubon to know about all the birds that somebody was writing about, and so forth and so on. So he was very, very thorough in the things he did. And he was a very good prose writer. He wrote history very well. He wrote some poetry, which he left behind, which is probably better left behind. And he wrote one sort of satirical piece about politics, which is not very good either. But now it's interesting. I keep learning more about the Baxters now that the book is out. And one of the things that I should have thought about, but I didn't, was here was a man who was 30 years president of the Maine Historical Society. How was it that none of his papers or none of Purcell's papers were left at the Maine Historical Society? I never thought about that. I just took it for granted that Purcell, all of his letters and scrapbooks are at the Maine State Library, and almost all of James Finney's material, including his journals and his letters, are at the Gorham Library, which he gave to Gorham, his birthplace. It's called the Baxter Library. And I learned in later years that it was because of the son of his partner, William Davis, a man named Walter Davis, who was an official in the Maine Historical Society, and I guess eventually succeeded him as president. They had a terrible falling out. It was never written about, but some of the people in the Maine Historical Society knew about it. So, as I say, I keep gathering more information. I mean, one of the ones that I heard from some of his relatives who had gotten was in Longfellow Square. Do you know where that is in Portland? There's a big statue of Longfellow sitting in a chair, and it said that when they had the unveiling of it, pulled down the cover, and underneath Longfellow was a chamber pot. and the personal Baxter had put it there. So these are some of the things. The last time James Phinney ran for mayor, he was going for his seventh term as a mayor, and people were saying, yeah, he's been in too long and all that. So he was finally beaten. He was beaten by a young, attractive young Democrat named Nathan Clifford from a very distinguished Portland family. And so he decided that was the end of his political career. But he spent a lot of time after that following his son, Percy's political career. He also spent a lot of time with the bank. He would take regular trips to Boston for the New England Historical and Genealogical Society, which he was a leading person in, then to Worcester for the Council of the Antiquarian Society. He was often a speaker. At the 250th anniversary of the town of York, he was on the platform as a speaker with Congressman Thomas Brackett Reed. We all know as was Speaker of the House of Representatives in Congress, called Zy Reed or Boss Reed. He was probably the most powerful speaker that the United States Congress has ever had. He was a man about 6'4", 300 pounds, huge, and probably the most incredible manipulator of the English language that I've ever read. And also a very close friend of James Phinney Baxter. They were great political friends. James Phinney had always fought very, very hard for him. And so they were on the platform in New York, along with Mark Twain, who summered in New York for a number of years. And so when James Phinney was 79, he was on a trip to Bermuda, and he met Mark Twain down there, and he wrote of him. Although nearly an octogenarian, he is alert and bright as a man of much fewer years, without mentioning that he was the same way himself. He lived until he was 90 years old. One of his final public appearances was a paper that he delivered on the history of Old Portland, and particularly the First Congregational Church, and the Reverend Thomas Smith, its famous 18th century pastor. This was part of the Maine Historical Society's celebration of the state's centennial in June 1920. And Percy was, he wasn't quite governor then, he was almost about to become governor, was quite concerned about the strain of this event on his frail father, but James Phinney carried it off with his usual ability. Less than a year later, on May 8th, 1921, James Phinney Baxter died. One final note. I noticed that you're having a exhibition on John Francis Spray. And as I say, in this process of going around, I'm always learning something new. And I never knew very much about John Francis Spray. I knew that there was something called Sprague's Journals. But what I didn't know, that he was had been in the elected to the legislature, and that he was there at the same time as Percival Baxter, and when Percy was governor, and that he was also a great supporter of saving Katahdin for the people of Maine, and that even earlier he had gotten a friend of his, a congressman named Frank Guernsey, from up in his area, Dover Foxcroft, to put a bill in Congress for a national Katahdin National Park in 1914, and that bill actually came up several times in Congress, but it never got passed. One thing that I had learned was that when Percy left office after his second term as governor, he had in his final speech to the legislature he had been trying to get them to buy Katahdin, both as a legislator and as a governor. They weren't willing to do it. He offered them to donate the equivalent of 2 years of salary to to them if they would use that to buy it. They turned him down again. But what they did do, and I knew about this, was they did make some of the area, Katahdin and the area around it, a game preserve. And that was sort of just a little piece in the background. And then what I've read recently was that that was John Francis Sprague's doing, that he had gotten that through the legislature. And so that sort of solved a little bit of the mystery for me. I wished I'd known it when I was writing this book, because I think it would have added another dimension. Anyway, I've gone on at some length. I'll be happy to answer any questions, and delighted again to be here with you. Thank you very much. And if anybody is interested, I brought some copies of the book. If you are interested in purchasing them, I'd be happy to sell them.
Okay, thank you very much.
We have did anybody
have any questions? Or I guess Dan has something he's up to now. So.
We have a copy of Randall Bennett's History of Bethel to
continue
your education in Bethel history. So find that his autograph from the author. So.
Wonderful. Oh, that's terrific. That's great. Thank you. Very, very nice.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, no questions.
Stan, where is there any refreshments or anything?
I think there's a few things over there if people want to take a little bite. We also maybe ought to open up the, somebody wants to see the John Francis Gray exhibit.
A little earlier we heard we heard the discussion about the necklace that Jackie Lewin is wearing here.
Very nice. Yes.
Yeah.
And I'm sure someone really
and right,
really happy.
Yeah.
Including myself.
And Jackie. I'd like to say again that this is Native Gems.
Yes.
And it's designed by Jim Mann and made by him. And is a project for the Capital Campaign. The tickets are chances for it are $20 each, and it's limited to 500 tickets, and the drawing will be Valentine's Day. What do you think of that, Gwyneth?
I think she thinks it's quite nice.
Well, thank you, Jackie, and tickets may be bought in several places around town. Thank you very much, Jackie.
Very nice of Jim Mann.
And that concludes this evening's program.
I can't hear what's going on.
I'm talking to the camera. And that concludes the annual meeting of the Bethel Historical Society. And I've been your videographer, trying at least to do something for it, Natalie Timberlake. And it was produced September 2nd, 1999 for Channel 4.
Oh, it's true. Oh, it's